When people talk about the birth of heavy metal, they generally talk about the great British bands like Black Sabbath and Led Zeppelin and Deep Purple. But America also played a really important role in the origins of this music. And you can't talk about American metal without talking about Kiss. The question for this episode is, what are the origins of American metal, and how do we get to Kiss?
The evolution of heavy music in America goes back much further than the explosion of Kiss in the 1970s. And if there's one style of early American music that was heavy for its time, it's surf music, especially the sound of the surf guitar.
And I've been thinking back to the first guitar riff my dad ever played for me, and it was a surf guitar song by the legendary Dick Dale. And I remember loving it because it had this real intense sort of shredding vibe to it. So I'm wondering, what place does surf music have in the history of metal? I read the little write-up on Dick Dale here at the museum. One of the first things it says, father of heavy metal.
That's what they called me. Critics would say his music sounds like the metallic galloping of two trains coming and just crashing. I didn't consider myself a guitar player. I don't know what an augmented ninth or 13th is, and I don't care. I just bang on that thing, and I make it scream with pain or pleasure, and I get sounds of Mother Nature. I heard about a man called Leo Fender. He'd say, well, how come you got to play so loud? You're blowing up my amplifiers. And I said, well, because I'm playing at a place called the Rendezvous Ballroom, and I want my guitar and speaker to sound like Gene Krupa. So the Stratocaster was built with a thick body so that it would give it that fat sound, and I put thick strings on it, give it a fatter sound. Then Leo created the first 100-watt output transformer peaking 180 watts. To this day, that's never been matched. People's ears started, whoa, what is this?
He took the guitar and turned it into a instrument, not just a small part of the music. He was able to do things on the guitar that nobody had ever seen before. He had been playing on a wall of amps like Van Halen had. Heavy metal may have been 20 years earlier.
Along with surf music, another genre that was a distinctly American contribution to early heavy metal was garage rock. And it doesn't get much more American than Ted Nugent, who long before he became the Motor City Madman, he was the guitarist for 60s garage rockers, the Amboy Dukes.
I've come all the way to his Spirit Wild Ranch, deep in the heart of Texas. And I think the real challenge is to not have Ted talk about hunting and politics and actually try and focus on the music.
Barack. Barack Obama.
You get that?
Got it.
Open
Ted Nugent.
Open the show with that mother.
Take three.
It's the only decent use I found for those syllables. Gas release.
You heard it here at the
no!
ranch.
All right, you're
hang
ready?
On, hang, on, hang on, hang on.
The who and
hang
I.
Hang on, hang on. God damn it. The Amboy Dukes, were you guys called garage rock?
Sure. The Amboy Dukes were the quintessential garage band. We had all the flailing Kerrang outrage, the uninhibitedness, the ferociousness of my Chuck Berry, Bo Diddley Dreams was as raw and unrefined as possible. All of us garage bands, all of us kids taught every band, okay, we can't play like anymore.
It was a bad boy attitude. You know, it was just like a swaggering attitude. Like, this is what we do. The volume kept going up. That was another thing. You know, you just happened to notice it. Now you're really starting to get this feeling.
When the English bands came over here, all brandishing guitars of some form or another, it was like, oh, we have to get back to where we started. And that's when you have all these garage bands in America suddenly taking root in every town all across the USA. That would certainly lay the groundwork for the next stage of what the music would become. Get your motor on.
The American garage rock movement created fertile ground for bands to experiment with heavy sounds in the mid-60s. And it was the Steppenwolf song Born to be Wild that not only pushed music in a heavier direction, but also featured the phrase heavy metal.
Was Steppenwolf the first band to use the term heavy metal?
To be honest with you, it doesn't really matter very much. I do know that from that time on, there were people who thought of Steppenwolf as being the band that was perhaps kind of a prototype for other bands to come, which eventually became heavy metal. Heavy metal thunder.
The drums are there, pulsing away, kicking ass. You know, you get the shivers when you hear the organ. The guitar is rolling. John Cale had that leadership voice of the generation. He didn't just tell you about it. He made a point of it. You know, it wasn't just a lecture. He beat people up in terms of telling them how they're going to live their life now, how things are going to change. After two dangerous times,
we were born to be wild. When we started playing some of the tunes we were kicking around, we realized that our sound was not only more aggressive and rocking heavier, but also we were not stretching out into these kind of ethereal sounding, you know, 8-minute songs that had long sweeping solos that, you know, etc. We were more like, make your statement and do it in a compact fashion and hit hard and then move on. Born to be
in the late 60s, rock music in America was becoming increasingly heavy and aggressive and loud. And one of the bands that often gets cited as the loudest of all time is California's Blue Cheer. Well, my mama, papa told my son, you got to make some money. And so I'm meeting with guitarist Randy Holden because I want to ask him, what was the attraction to playing at such punishing volume? Tell me about San Francisco at the time, and to what extent you guys were breaking free from the typical San Francisco scene.
The psychedelic vibe kind of commingled with folk music and rock, and that was, you know, it had its place, I suppose. For myself, I was always attracted to a minor key and powerful notes. I was tuning my guitar to D, a whole step note down from the time I was playing surf music. And I did it because I just loved the sound of that thunder.
When Blue Cheer started, in San Francisco at the time, the music scene was so wide open. I mean, there were no rules. I mean, it was the only way a band like Blue Cheer could have surfaced was in that environment, because we were going against all the grains. We were too loud. Our music was too simple. We weren't sophisticated enough. We were rowdy. We were obnoxious little punks.
In many ways, they were the first metal band, but they didn't think in terms of metal. It was volume that they were all about, and fury.
What was the appeal to you of playing so loud?
I don't know. I'm born with that. That's just something that just, it totally takes me away. There's something, there's beauty in that. I would sit and imagine, what would it sound like if you were right there when a nuclear explosion went off? And I thought, if you had enough amplifiers, you could come close to that maybe.
The most important city in the development of early metal in the U.S. is Detroit. So I've come to the Motor City to meet with Wayne Kramer, guitarist for the legendary Detroit band the MC5, to find out why this city became the epicenter of heavy music back in the late 60s.
Can you describe what things were like back then?
There was a sense of urgency in finding a militant position to take to oppose the disastrous direction things were going in. Every day there were developments on the national and international scene, political developments that poured gasoline on the fire. Flower power was nice, but that wasn't enough power. My generation was in agreement that the way our parents were doing things completely was a disaster. And the only chance we got is to say something about it and say it as loud as we can. And we found that electric guitars were a good way to do that. There was an aesthetic that developed in Detroit, unique in the world. And it kind of gave me the sense that, you know, I don't have to live in New York. I don't have to live in London. You know, I don't have to live in San Francisco. We got something going on here. And we were all influenced by the industrial base of Detroit. This idea of metal and the noise showed up in the music.
I think the music really, more than anything else, was a reaction to the industrial nature of Detroit. You were either working on cars or selling cars, or thinking about cars.
Or stealing cars.
Every weeknight, clubs would be full of workers that were working days or working afternoons, and they could stay in the bars till 2 a.m, and so bands could play. So there was a lot going on for a musician.
We had all the California bands, like the Grateful Dead and Janis Joplin and Big Brother, but the Summer of Love never made it to Detroit. We like things that really got us off, you know, simple, direct, over-the-top, make you move, make you want to dance stuff. The MC5, especially Wayne Kramer, they would go, kick out the jams, mother, get off the stage, meaning that this is a weak performance, just get out of here. And that just became kind of their tag phrase, their motto.
Kick out the jams, mother.
So why does the MC5 get included in the conversation about heavy metal?
Well, the MC5 gets the credit or the blame, and I'll take both, for what came to be known as metal and punk rock. Wasn't my plan. Guys like Townsend, Jeff Beck, Jimmy Page. I was heavily influenced by these guys. And when I combined that with what I was hearing from the free jazz movement, I thought, well, this is clearly the next step. I can do things with the guitar to make it sound very un-guitar-like.
I thought I was a bad mother on the guitar. I thought the Amboy Dukes were bad mother had that James Brown, Wilson Pickett, Sam and Dave shake going out. Then I saw the MC5. It was stupefying.
My life changed by the MC5. A great show band, beyond politics, beyond anything, a great loud roar of high energy, complemented on the other side by the complete simplicity and directness of the Stooges. Listen, that's your sister now, kid.
Walk across the USA. While the MC5 created a sound that hadn't been heard before in America, another Detroit band that took music to new levels of rawness and intensity in the late 60s was Iggy and the Stooges.
When we were forming our group, the Stooges, before we were ever on stage, we'd all liked heavier rock. It just made me feel like it had an inner, unstated message to assert myself in a primal way, to take the sex when I wanted it, to take money when I wanted it, to be somebody, not to have a job, to be somebody. She had a TV on me. She had a TV on. She had a TV on me. No. When we first play those songs, people would do this. I mean, literally, if there was any room to get back, most people got back, but they didn't want to leave. Mm. And some people, the type that later became called stoners or sluts, those are our two big fan bases, and then a few intellectuals. They'd come forward, and the others would peak in horror from the back of the place, and the shit sounded heavy. That's what it was desperately important to me to be. Now we're gonna be face to face. And I'll lay right down in my favorite place. And now I wanna be your star. I think one thing that allows people to find all sorts of stuff in our music is that we never really stuck it out in your face too much. It was in your face in one way, but in another way it had a kind of a sullen, an inward quality that you also find in goth music, grunge music, metal music. Well, come on.
The Detroit bands established a new direction in heavy music in the late 60s. But Detroit's reign as the epicenter of American hard rock was short-lived. By the early 70s, the legendary Grandy Ballroom had closed, and the MC5 and Iggy and the Stooges had fallen apart due to drug problems. But there would be one Detroit musician who would eventually drag American hard rock out of the underground and into the mainstream. The story of American heavy metal would not be complete without the Alice Cooper Band. They're one of the most extreme live acts of all time, and they've also written some of heavy metal's most memorable radio anthems. So how did this outrageous underground band from Detroit get their start?
Every weekend at the Grandy or the East Town or these great rock dungeons, it was like, you know, the MC5, Iggy and Alice. Iggy was the king of the punks, and I was this other thing. I was this sort of, you know, Phantom of the Opera kind of character. We loved it. I mean, you know, we could go as far as we wanted to go on stage. And I mean, it was always, who's crazier, Iggy or Alice?
What do you think enabled you guys to achieve that marriage between a harder sound and yet also be accessible on radio?
It was time, and we had a producer named Bob Ezrin who got it. He heard us at Max's Kansas City, he heard 18, and he went, oh. He says, what's that song, I'm Edgy? And I said, there's Edgy. I said, you mean 18? And he goes, yeah. He says, that song is so dumb. Mm-hmm. It's a hit. We would play it, and he would go, no, dumb it down. The song is about a guy that's, I'm 18, I'm a boy, I'm a man, and I dig it.
I'm 18 and I like it.
Mike Bruce was writing great pop stuff that then the band would take and make into hard rock. And then Alice had these, you know, strange ideas and sensibilities that he would inject into the lyrics. The job that I had was to take all of those elements and to organize them in a way that brought a kind of spine to each of the songs.
Bob knew how to take our insanity and make it into a real palatable package. Songs like 18 and School's Out. Even if you hate Alice Cooper, you have to like those records because they're fun to listen to.
18, I gotta get away.
Radio have a significant role in catapulting Alice?
The Alice Cooper Group owe their career to radio. It was actually Rosalie Tremblay, who was at CKLW, the Big Eight, in Windsor, Ontario, on the other side of the river from Detroit, who heard our sad little rendition of I'm 18.
She heard this record, and her son liked it. And she had a teenage son. Her son said, that's the coolest record. So she added it. And the next thing you know, it got request, and it was a major hit. Now, if you were a hit on CKLW, that means that was the biggest station in the Midwest. If you got a hit on CKLW, you had a national hit. Radio-wise, we were a bit of an oddity. The hardest rock thing on the radio at that time probably was the Guess Who. To crack the top 40, you were up against Motown, Burt Bacharach. In order to get in that top 40, you had to have a record that really made a dent, that made people go, what was that? You know, and that's what 18 did.
And then after that, we were looked at like a radio act.
Yeah.
It was kind of expected. It wasn't a matter of trying to get radio anymore. It was, radio was waiting for the next thing we were gonna do.
With I'm 18 on the charts and School's Out hitting number one in the UK, Alice Cooper was now a household name. But radio success was an anomaly for hard rock bands during the 1970s. For most bands, touring was the only way to reach audiences. And there's no better example of a successful touring act than Kiss.
I wanted to get your perspective on how touring became so critical during the 70s.
In the early days, I remember playing certain places where I knew the people weren't huge fans when we walked in. People in the audience after, you know, the first couple of songs, you know, some of them would be sitting in like this going, all right, prove it. Halfway through the show, the people were up. And then, you know, by the time the drums levitated and everything blew up, they walked out of the club, you know, fans.
You know, we do the show, sell it out. They were cheering, smiling. We got a lot of girls that night, had a great party. And they go back and go, why aren't we on the radio? Next day we read the papers. It said we sucked. We were loud, we were boisterous, we were out of control. They don't understand us. This band should be killed or shot or hung. What's wrong here?
If you're not getting played on the radio,
you have to play it to the people directly. This is before MTV, this is before YouTube. Touring was really the only way that they could get their music out to the people. So these guys are touring incessantly.
There was a cult thing to where a band would come to town and you had a 500 or 600 people that were saying, I want to see this band. But even Kiss, they didn't explode on their first record. You know, they went out and worked and opened for people and busted their balls out on the road.
Here's a band who was only played on FM radio, got very little top 40 airplay, which is what most bands in those days had to get to explode. We had left Warner Brothers, who was our distributor, and we had none of our own money, and we couldn't afford to put them back in the studio. So what we did was do a live album, because we really had no other choice.
Rock and roll all night, party every day!
Why do a live record?
Desperation. I mean, we were like at the end of our rope. We were so frustrated that we could not get our sound on vinyl. We hear a lot of other English bands. You hear from Zeppelin to Who, all these other bands. A few bands by then did do live albums, and they sounded phenomenal. Why can't we do this? And finally, Eddie Kramer came into the picture, and we went out on the road with Eddie with a bunch of trucks, and we recorded every night live. When we went and listened every night in the trailer, that it was so exciting because what we were missing was the audience, the screaming, the kids involved in the energy of the music. And we thought, now this is what kids will bring home to their living room and get partied out and get crazed and stoned and put it on and party all night long.
We never thought it would explode the way it exploded. Nobody did. The live album gave this energy that no studio album could capture with this band. It was for fans who saw them and wanted to relive it, and it was for fans who didn't see them and got off on what was going on, the excitement.
It was the right record at the right time, and it gave the band a shot in the arm, because prior to that, the first three albums did okay. We weren't a million-selling album group. If a live would have failed, you know, I don't know what would have happened. You know, but Kistry is Kistry.
Alive was Kiss's first album to reach the top 10 and is still the band's longest charting record of all time. So now that Kiss and Alice Cooper were selling millions of records, what did it take to bring the rest of the American hard rock genre into mainstream culture? In the early 70s, Kiss wasn't the only American hard rock band building a devoted fan base through their live show. Kiss's main competitor was Boston's Aerosmith. Aerosmith has sold 150 million albums and holds the record for the most gold and platinum albums by an American group. But Aerosmith's musical contribution to the evolution of heavy metal remains largely untold. So I'm meeting with bassist and founding member Tom Hamilton to find out where the Aerosmith sound came from and why it made such a big impact back in the early 70s.
Joe and I had been playing together in bands before Aerosmith when we were teenagers. We loved Fleetwood Mac, Led Zeppelin. We technically weren't great musicians. We just got the loudest amps we could, turned them up, and played as fast as we could. Steven was sort of on a parallel route with his bands. They were very professional, very polished, more toward pop. Joey was way into funk bands, Kool & the Gang and James Brown. When we finally met up and got together, those elements developed into the sound of the band.
Aerosmith, to me, is a swing band. All their riffs are basically horn charts transposed to the guitar. I mean, Aerosmith are really taking the Rolling Stones and combining it with Led Zeppelin. Boy, talk about a surefire formula for success.
They had a certain kind of swagger that sort of developed and progressed from record to record. I just love the sort of misfit, almost hopeless screw-ups that they sort of sounded like on record, but with this great backbeat and this sort of like anxiety-ridden kind of delivery.
When we first came out, you know, Rolling Stone just said these guys are just a, you know, second-rate Stones ripoff, basically, you know. Oh, I get it. You know, Jagger, Richards. The rock press wanted to hear a little bit more, you know, of an intellectual component from their bands, and we were just about, you know, rocking out.
Aerosmith was a sore thumb because I think at that point in time, Columbia looked at Aerosmith as being, in their eyes, déclassé, like the difference between where Harvard and you belong at some local school kind of thinking.
We just had to go out on the road and, you know, now you would call it viral marketing. Get on the best tours we could, opening for whatever band. We opened for some weird people back then, but it was a crowd. We didn't care. And so eventually, you know, we just built that up to a critical mass.
As you know, I mean, the band really started to hit big with the album, Toys in the Attic.
Toys in the Attic had Sweet Emotion and Walk This Way. Dream On as a single came out off of the first album, and I think may have cleared the high 70s and fell off the charts. After we had success, I convinced Columbia to re-release Dream On, and it went to number 6.
I remember the first time hearing one of our songs on the radio. That's when Dream On became a hit. I realized, oh my God, if I'm hearing it, that means there's like thousands of other people listening to it right now for the first time. And it was such an amazing rush. All at once, the whole thing just gave way. And we were this big band. And we were playing in front of 50, 60,000 people. We had reached a creative pinnacle, and we were starting to become successful, doing something like what we idolized. Boy, were we having a fun time at that point.
With Aerosmith cracking AM radio on Toys in the Attic, they opened the door for other American hard rock bands to hit it big on radio. But there's no 70s hard rock song more radio-friendly than Kiss's power ballad, Beth.
Beth, I hear you calling, but I can't come home right now. Me and the boys are playing, and we just can't find a sound.
Tell me the story of how you came to work on Destroyer and specifically Beth.
The first thing that happened was that I saw them play live in, I believe it was Saginaw, Michigan, in a 9,000-seater. And what was remarkable about it was that from the moment they started playing, people were up on their feet and they never sat down. They just stayed on their feet through the whole concert and yelled and screamed and pumped their arms in the air, and then they left and they were very happy. But the whole crowd was made up of 15-year-old boys. So then I met them and I said, you know, we gotta expand your horizons here and your fan base. What we have to do is to make you more attractive, a little more romantic. So in looking through Peter's material, he had this thing called Beck.
And I said, I got a great song, man. And I know we don't do ballads, God forbid, the band don't do, you know, because the band, that was the rules. We'll never, ever do a ballad as long as we live. And so I spruced it up and I upped the beat and I sang it to Gene. He goes, no, it's not so bad. And finally, when Ezrin got to rehearsals, I sang it for Bobby, and he said, no, I hear it much lower. And I think we should call it Beth.
It was almost like a country song. It was sort of folky, you know. It had a kind of little bounce to Beck, I hear you calling. So I said to Peter, do you mind if I take this home and play around with it a little bit? And he said, no, go ahead. Once I hit that little riff in the piano, I suddenly heard a lush, you know, orchestral approach to this thing, and I heard a lush ballad. Then the job was to go back and sell Kiss, you know, the and balls masters of the universe, on the idea of doing a song with a piano and an orchestra.
Gene and Paul, they hated it. So the day even when I had to go in to sing it, the two of them was sitting there in the console as I was out of the room. And they're doing this, and they're doing this to me. So Ezrin threw them out. And sure enough, by throwing them out, we got it on maybe the fifth take. And it came out beautiful.
Just a few more hours, and I'll be back home to you.
The album went out, and they wound up putting it on the B-side of Detroit Rock City. And sure enough, a DJ in Georgia flipped it over one day for the hell of it. He put it on, and then the phone started ringing, and it was like, you know, play that song again. Once Beth got on, everything got on. Everything went gold, everything started being played.
Beth was a big shot in the arm for us. It gave us exposure to people that normally wouldn't even know who Kiss was. That album sold twice as many copies because of that one song. We all got houses and cars out of it too, you know, that didn't hurt.
Just me and the boys will be playing all night.
I'm talking to you people over here. I'd appreciate it if you stand up again and move to your rear, please. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Ted Nugent.
By 1978, American hard rock was peaking, and there was no bigger celebration of this music than Cal Jam 2, a massive two-day festival in the heart of Southern California. 4 years earlier, Cal Jam 1 featured British metal bands Black Sabbath and Deep Purple. But by 78, the focus had shifted to American bands.
What happens between 74 and 78 here?
Well, you started seeing a transition. All of a sudden, American bands started doing a sound that attracted a wider base audience. And that was Nugent, Hart, Foreigner, Aerosmith, of course. And we drew 100,000 more people with that show than we did the show in 74.
It was a great, great day. The audience was awesome. It was perfect. It was just a sea of unified celebration.
What are your memories of Cal Jam 2?
We were staying at the Beverly Hills Hotel, and every half an hour, somebody was coming in saying, my God, there's 175,000 people. No, there's 250,000. There's 300,000. Until there were 350,000 people there. And the thought that way out in the darkness, there people were just going all the way to this invisible horizon was really cool.
Strategically, we're at a point where I'm beginning to see cracks in Aerosmith, and part of my thinking was to try and do these giant events to build sort of a canopy over them while they recovered, because it was not fun by then.
We were starting to make money, and we were starting to buy, instead of just little packets of stuff, we could buy bags of it. It was so decadent. One of the sad things about our history is that, you know, moments like that are inspiring and really exciting, but they're also, it brings out a lot of intensity that somehow got the better of us. Talk about monkeys with guns, you know, you give these guys this situation, and what do? They get burnt out and up and blow it.
In the wake of Cal Jam 2, Aerosmith started to freefall, and their record sales were declining. So given that the biggest band in American hard rock was struggling, what was the state of the rest of the hard rock genre?
The record industry is hurting badly. Sales are way down.
And a lot of the big groups that were made the 70s are really starting to either break up or burn out or sell out.
Hard rock became kind of irrelevant to a whole new crop of people interested in music. You started seeing music dissect and diversify as the beginning of disco even started.
Disco. Disco killed so much in its wake.
I was made for loving you, baby.
I know. But you know, yeah, I have no excuse for that. I was made for loving you, baby. You were made for loving me. And I can't get enough of you, baby. Can you get enough of me?
Disco song. They bitched about a ballad. We're doing disco now. It was like, to me, Black Sabbath doing a disco song. I could not see Ozzy singing a disco song.
There were a lot of bands who weren't disco doing disco songs. Kiss saw what was happening with Donna Summer and the Village People and Cher, and they saw the sales and how huge this was becoming. Knowing Gene and Ace and everybody, they probably said, well, if we could sell more records and make more money, we'll give it a shot.
I Was Made for Loving You was a huge departure, and it was something I wasn't really happy about either, you know, because it was started to get into the disco vein, but somehow it happened, and it was a big hit. But do you want to be remembered for it is a big question.
Kiss doing disco put the nail in the coffin for American heavy metal, and by the late 70s, Cream magazine had declared it officially dead. But it was California newcomers Van Halen that helped reinvigorate metal in America. So what exactly was new about the sound of Van Halen?
When I first heard Van Halen, it was just like, wow. The overall vibe of Van Halen was very energetic and very, very new sounding, very fresh sounding. And it had a ton of attitude. It was just in your face.
It was time to give up on Styx. You know, it was time to give up on Foghat. Even though those guys might have been 20 or 25, they look like they're 40 with those mustaches. When the first Van Halen album came out, like, it just blew me away. We'd never heard anything like that put together in that kind of way with the hooks and the hard edge.
When we came on the scene, we didn't want to be pigeonholed into one kind of genre, so we would always tell everybody, no, we're big rock. Because it was just something that was different, you know? Van Halen plays big rock.
We got everything. We got enough food and booze for about 500-700 people here this evening, you know? Originally, what we were going to do is we were going to turn all the equipment around backwards and show our behind to the audience, and that way everybody be backstage.
And Van Halen recapture what I think hard rock lost in the 70s, and that's sort of a Dionysian celebration. Particularly with the rise of more distinct heavy metal, they lost that feeling of celebration. And Van Halen are all about that.
They came on crazy, drinking frickin' straight out of the bottle and doing drugs and got the chicks. They just opened it up for Poison, opened up for Motley Crue. Van Halen were the next generation, in my opinion, of reinventing metal.